Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship at Plainfield United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Hannah, one of the pastors here, and it's good to be back and with all of you in Sunday morning worship. And thank you for choosing to worship with us this Sunday morning. We hope you will connect with God today. Thank you for braving the cold weather this morning to join us. It may be very cold outside, but it's nice and warm in here. And we'll get an opportunity to sing and kind of warm up our souls a little bit this morning. And a big thanks to the PUMC youth for clearing our sidewalks on Friday. The kids who shoveled were Alex and Trevor Dunn, Cameron Zick, and Henry Negro. So glory to God, and thank you to the youth for their help. At this time, I invite you to stand for a moment and greet one another however you're comfortable this morning.
Everyone, please join us in the call to worship. O gracious and holy God,
give us wisdom to perceive you,
intelligence to understand you,
give us diligence to seek you,
patience to wait for you,
give us eyes to see you, and our hearts to meditate on you,
and give us, O God, a life to proclaim you, through the power of the Spirit, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Please be seated.
Welcome. It is really good to be here with you again this morning. If you're joining us online, thank you. We're thrilled to have you here with us. wherever you're joining us from. Thanks for making Plainfield United Methodist Church part of your weekend, and we're delighted to welcome you as part of our church family. If you are with us for the first time, thank you. I know church can feel intimidating, but we invite you to join the great body of Christ, the great family of Christ. So we are so glad that you're here. Whether you're new or can't remember how many times you've been here, which that would be me, we invite you to complete a connection card. We'd love to hear from you. You can find a digital version at pumc.org /next steps, or a paper card is located in the hymnal in the pew rack there. We can receive your paper card along with your offering. We offer worship in many styles, including children's Sunday school and youth worship each week. You can find more information about our worship schedule at pumc.org. We have a few things we want everyone to know about today. Next week, we begin a collection in the main lobby for Imagine No Malaria. And this is a United Methodist effort to help eliminate disease in Africa. So just be ready for that. And also today we celebrate Holy Communion. And it is a celebration, and it is a Holy Communion. And we celebrate here in the Methodist Church with an open table. That means all ages and all faiths, our backgrounds are invited and welcome to fully participate at God's table where Jesus is the host. For the live stream worshipers, please use crackers or any bread and grape juice or water with enough for everyone in your location. It is a joy to be here.
The Bible. It's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how He created us and loves us so much that He made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. And now for an amazing story.
Good morning, kids at PUMC. Good morning, neighbors. My name is Charity Ayton, and I work here in preschool programs and in children's ministry, and I have neighbors. Do you have neighbors? It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? So we are all neighbors to each other. We have neighbors at home. We have neighbors here in church sitting next to us. We have neighbors in the community. So, won't you be my neighbor? So, today we are learning about compassion, and compassion is caring enough for others to do something that meets someone else's needs, not our own, but someone else's. So, if you're sick, who do you call? You call a doctor. If your cat is up in the tree in your yard, who do you call? Well, you're probably gonna call somebody with a really big ladder, which just might be a firefighter. And if you need to learn something or take lessons or go to school, who do you go to? You go to a teacher. So all of those people have a purpose, okay? So we're gonna wrap this back around. Jesus had a purpose, and His purpose was to love people. He loved people that were sick. He loved people that were forgotten. He loved people that were in jail. He loved the poor, the sick, the hungry, the hurting, and the overlooked. He loves everyone. He does not judge them. He loves them. And we are to follow His purpose in life. So some of our purposes might be one or another, like a doctor or a pastor or a lawyer or an accountant, or you may need, there may be the people that work at grocery stores that, you know, set everything up. Walmart, Target, Meijer, gas stations, we all have a purpose. And in those jobs and roles in life, even being neighborly, we are to love each other, right? That's our purpose in life. We want to love like Jesus. So, how can we do that? How can we do that as kids or as human beings or even adults? We can. This church is so full of ways that we can help. We have a homeless ministry. You can ride along. You can donate cookies and food. When you're at school eating lunch and you see someone that doesn't have very much food, you can share your lunch with them. If you see someone being bullied, you can stand up for them and say, hey, that's not right. That's not fair. You can also give your clothes away. When you outgrow your clothes, you can give them away to someone. You can give away your toys. There are so many ways you can love like Jesus and be a good neighbor. So we all have that favorite neighbor, right? Do we go out and have block parties or shovel each other's driveways? All of those things, we can help our neighbors, but our neighbors are bigger than that. Our neighbors are all around us. Our church is an excellent example of a good neighbor. We have so many things to do. So I hope everyone enjoyed this lesson. I want you to have a good purpose in life, and that purpose is to be kind and love one another. I hope all of you have a great day, and I will see you in Sunday school.
I want to thank all that are here online, everybody, for your continued financial support of the ministry. You can find all the ways you can make a financial gift at pumc.org/give. For those present for worship on site, we are glad to receive your gifts and connection cards in the plates at the entrance and the exit of the worship space as you pass by. Thank you for those who continue to regularly support the work and worship and mission here. I'd invite you to pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we just praise you and thank you for you gave it all to us through your Son, Jesus Christ, and the message of salvation through him by the power of the Holy Spirit. So we just thank you for that gift. We return to you a portion of our earnings that you've given to us, and we just ask you to bless them and to help us to steward them in a way that would glorify you and build your family. We pray all these things in the holy name of Jesus. Amen. Because God gives, we give. Thank you for your generosity. And also want to mention, we have a prayer blanket today. It's to Tim Moss, and it's from Tim Hansen with prayers for healing and comfort. Thank you.
Today's scripture lesson is from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. If you're following along in the Red Pew Bible, you'll find the reading on page 582. If you're using your own Bible or mobile device, we're in Isaiah chapter 40, verses 21 through 31. Listen for how the Lord sustains those who wait for God. Reading Isaiah 40, verses 21 through 31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sets above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers. Who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in? Who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing? Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown. Scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Grace and peace to you.
Grace and peace to you.
We give a knowing smile when the children in our lives struggle to wait for their birthday or some other special occasion. Time goes by so slowly for kids, and I'm convinced it's because 1 week of their life is a larger percentage of the time they've lived than for, say, you or me. Then there's Christmas. Kids just cannot wait. They get so impatient the closer they get. They feel like they've been exiled to Christmas will never get here land. The 1983 movie, A Christmas Story, tells about little Ralphie, and the movie's narrated by Ralphie as an adult. Near the beginning of the movie, adult Ralphie sets the stage for the movie by saying, "Christmas was on its way, lovely, glorious, beautiful Christmas, upon which the entire kid year revolved." And because I know you're all eager to know this fact, it's only 322 sleeps until Christmas. I knew you were just dying to know. You can find the countdown on emailsanta.com. They give the countdown in any category of time you want. It's rendered in months, in days, in weeks, hours, minutes, and even seconds. And there is a live, real-time countdown timer. Kids get it, the impatience. Listen to some kids talk about why it's hard to be patient.
Why is it hard to be patient?
Because you want to do fun things. And then you have to do something bad in a snap film, like take out the garbage, like I usually have to.
Some things are so excited they can't really wait for them very long. I can only wait like 2 minutes for something to happen. Then I'm just so impatient that I can't stand it any longer.
I don't necessarily like being patient, but when I know I have to, I do.
If you weren't patient, then, like, you would just say, "I want it done right now." "No, Mom, I want dinner right now or else." So it would kind of turn into a bossy world.
That's great. Don't you love that one? If you were like, "Mom, I want dinner right now or else," it would turn into kind of a bossy world. Yeah. Christmas or a birthday are probably the biggest challenges to a kid's patience, yeah? And it may be the first time kids hear it, that famous family saying, "A watched pot never boils." We all know that. Everything in its time, and as true as that is, it doesn't make waiting any easier for kids or for us. You may be waiting for something. It may be a tax refund, a bonus, or a promotion at work. You may be waiting for your online purchase to arrive. You may be waiting for spring weather or something else. Maybe you can't wait to complete some training or education to get a qualifying credential for work or your personal development. It can be frustrating that we cannot make these things happen on our schedule by sheer force of will. Being forced to wait can feel like being set aside, confined, exiled, you might say. But there is a force at work. God is at work in the world and in us. When we choose to release the pressures and practice patience, some amazing things happen. God provides in our patience. Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be all acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. But patience runs counter to our culture. We seem to live with a growing expectation of instant gratification. We've all had microwaves for a long time now, and now we have streaming services on our televisions to watch any movie or entertainment instantly. Amazon has same-day delivery. It's amazing. Comedian Stephen Wright famously said, "I put my instant coffee in the microwave, and I think I went back in time." What is it that makes you lose your patience? It's especially tough when you're hangry. Those old Snicker commercials were really on point. But it's really not that much of a joke. Remember HALT, H-A-L-T, hungry, angry, lonely, tired. When you're suffering from two or more of those, you're at risk and you're not at your best. Makes you feel pressure, like you're living in exile. Being impatient, it's just not good for you either. The studies show that impatience speed up the effects of aging. And who wants to get older faster, right? It seems like patience really will relieve the pressure and make you lighter. Memorable proverbs and sayings bring the truth home. A watch pot never boils, we've said. Everything in its time, from Ecclesiastes 3, for everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. You can't rush it. You can either live under pressure or practice patience. That's the choice we're considering today in this Make Good Choices worship series. I bet you've said it to your kids, make good choices. We did too, and our grandchildren hear it most every day. And as we survey common proverbial wisdom, looking at them alongside the Bible, it'll help us make good choices in the new year. We do have the power to freely choose. Too many people I know have the attitude of defeat. It doesn't matter what I do, nothing will change. The outcome is already rigged. And you know, being cynical is a choice too. The truth is that ultimately the only power we have is the power to choose our response to things in life. Trouble or stress may give you a shot of adrenaline and make you feel uncomfortable. I get that. A friend of mine used to say that the first shot of adrenaline is free. Your body reacts automatically. But the second shot of adrenaline, that's on you, they used to say. You can choose to calm and center. You can choose your response. Because you have to be able to choose in order to live in love. Love relationships have to come from free choice. And more than anything else, God wants a love relationship with you that is real, personal, and practical. Yes, that's right. A love relationship with you and everyone around you. You can choose, and your choices have consequences. So, will you live under pressure or practice patience? One of my biggest challenges with patience was after I graduated from college, but before I was able to begin grad school, seminary. I grew up Presbyterian, and in the middle of my freshman year of college, I discerned God's call to pastoral ministry, changed my academic major, transferred to the University of Evansville. Donna and I were married after my sophomore year. I graduated with a liberal arts degree, a great degree, excellent preparation for seminary, but really not a helpful degree for any other pursuit in life. I was driving forklift full-time at the time and making good money, and Donna was working at the daycare center at Methodist Temple there in Evansville. I tried to get into a few different seminaries. The money just was not working out. not enough scholarships or no scholarships, and we just couldn't afford it. And the waiting was very difficult for me. The delay stretched from 1 year and looked like it was going to stretch into the second year. It seemed like we were being set aside or taken away from what God had for us. A time of being set aside, put on the shelf, as it were, a time of exile, so to speak. And exile is something that the Bible has a lot to say about. And that brings us to our scripture reading for today in Isaiah. So, in Bible times, the military superpowers would take over a nation and then cripple them by deporting their leaders, leaving only enough workers in the land to pay heavy taxes. And it happened to the Israelites in Jerusalem in 598 BCE and again several years later. The Babylonians defeated them and took a large group of leaders away to Babylon as slaves. Exiles. The part of Isaiah that we read today was written during this exile. The Jews were impatiently waiting to return to the promised land, God's gift to them. After Cyrus of Persia captured Babylon, he did allow the exiles to return to Jerusalem in 539 BCE. Now, Isaiah begins his book discussing the agony the nation had faced being conquered and disrupted with so many deported into exile. And then the book of Isaiah takes a decisive turn in chapter 40. The first few verses, "Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term." You see, Old Testament prophets are less fortune-telling and more forth-telling in proclaiming God's messages to the people from God's point of view. Like, "Thus says the Lord," and then they speak God's messages. And Isaiah has a word of hope from God for the impatient exiled Jews who are waiting to go back home to the promised land. The people are obviously wondering if God is even able. After all, it would seem that the God of the Babylonians had won the day. Not only the day, but several decades. And Isaiah is bringing evidence, like in a legal dispute, evidence of God's power and ability to deliver, and demonstrating how the idols and the false gods of other nations are powerless by comparison. Hearing it again in the message helps me to get it. "Have you not been paying attention? Have you not been listening? Haven't you heard these stories all your life? Don't you understand the foundation of all things? God sits high above the round ball of earth. The people look like mere ants. God stretches out the skies like a canvas, yes, like a tent canvas to live under. He ignores what all the princes say and do. The rulers of the earth count for nothing. Princes and rulers don't amount to much. Like seeds barely rooted, just sprouted, they shrivel when God blows on them. Like flecks of chaff, they're gone with the wind. So who is like me? Who holds a candle to me?" says the Holy. "Look at the night skies. Who do you think made all this? Who marches this army of stars out each night, counts them off, calls each by name, so magnificent, so powerful, and never overlooks a single one?" Verse 27 brings the real issue home. If Judah in exile knows all of these things about the Lord, see, then why are they in despair that God does not know or regard their predicament? Verse 27. "Why would you ever complain, O Jacob, or whine, Israel, saying, 'God has lost track of me. He doesn't care what happens to me.' Don't you know anything? Haven't you been listening? God doesn't come and go. God lasts. He's creator of all you can see or imagine. He doesn't get tired out, doesn't pause to catch his breath. He knows everything inside and out." Isaiah compares God to a redeemer, a legal term for a family member with standing to come to the aid of family members in crisis or in trouble. A brand new way to understand God brought to us through the prophet Isaiah. And this advocate, Redeemer God, is everywhere, all the time, even in Babylon, wherever you are, wherever you may feel like you have been exiled to, God is there, and God is able. Then starting with verse 29, we get this liberating, life-changing promise from the Redeemer Lord, who is able in everything, in every place, and in every time. God energizes those who get tired, gives fresh strength to dropouts. For even young people tire and drop out. Young folk in their prime stumble and fall. But those who wait upon God get fresh strength. They spread their wings and soar like eagles. They run and don't get tired. They walk and don't lag behind. Those who wait upon the Lord. The sense of the word here is to step out of exile and into expectation, to step out of the prison of impatience into the provision of God, to look to God, not other sources that are unable to deliver, to have hope that expects God to act in your life for good. That's what hope is, to wait for the Lord, to trust in the Lord. Also, the sense of this verb is like to collect all your eggs in one basket, so to speak, and to put it all in your hope and expectation for God, not God and something else, not God and some plan B that you may have cooking on the stovetop. Waiting on just the Lord, because God has your best at heart and God will come through. Wait upon the Lord. God provides in our patience. When do you struggle the most to wait? As the creator of the universe, is there anything that God cannot make happen? How will you wait patiently for God this week? With wings like eagles. When a storm is coming, all the other birds seek shelter. They say that the eagle alone avoids the storm by flying above it. So in the storms of life, may your heart soar like an eagle. Placing yourself in God's care does put you above the storm and apart from exile. So back to those 2 years that we were waiting to get to seminary, I really struggled to trust God during that waiting time. I kept praying, hoping, and trusting. I hung in there with God's call on my life to ministry. I didn't pursue any permanent plan B, and God brought a fresh breeze. God used that time to do several different things. I prayed long and hard about staying Presbyterian or becoming United Methodist, and we all know how that turned out. What a distinct, powerful, incredible blessing for our lives. And without that time out, so to speak, I probably would not have devoted enough time, thought, or prayer to that discernment. God also used that time to direct my attention to the seminary at Emory University, my alma mater. I applied for a competitive scholarship, and that, along with the support of the annual conference, brought us to a great place, and our student appointment in Williamson, Georgia, was a rich, powerful experience. That waiting season, in hindsight, was a part of God's plan, and I'll confess, Donna was far more patient and at peace during that 2-year waiting period than I was. Through it all, God gave renewed strength and spirit. God provides in our patience. Patience is the way you want to be. Sitting with the Lord, trusting the Lord, expecting the Lord to act. 3 Sundays ago, I shared a devotion by Max Lucado. It's a new day, the choice is yours. It's based on the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5. And here's what Max said about patience in that devotion. I choose patience. I will overlook the inconveniences of the world. Instead of cursing the one who takes my place, I'll invite Christ to do so. Rather than complain that the wait is too long, I will thank God for a moment to pray. Instead of clenching my fist at new assignments, I will face them with joy and courage. Now, if you think that somehow this promise in Isaiah that God renews us as we patiently wait on God, if you think it's just for the Old Testament, please think again. After Jesus was crucified, the disciples were depressed, dejected, and scared to death of the authorities. They were exiled, so to speak, as well. Then Jesus comes and appears to them and fulfills this passage in Isaiah. Jesus breathes on them the spirit and the breath and the wind of God. The word means all of those things. Jesus speaks peace and deliverance to them. Jesus lifts them up. It's in John 20. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Our Creator God has the whole world, you included, under the divine, gracious gaze. God wants good for you. God's got the entire world well in hand. Our next musical selection is On Eagle's Wings. You, along with the choir, will bring it together as Brent will lead you here in a few moments. First words of the song say, "You who dwell in the shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow for life, say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom I trust." From Psalms 91, "I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust." When you step out of exile into expectation, when you step out of the prison of impatience into the provision of God, when you wait for God and trust God, you experience the truth of God's promise and provision. And the chorus says it so well. "And God will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of God's hand." Let's pray. Gracious and loving God, forgive us when our expectations get out of control. Forgive us when our expectations drive us to such impatience. Help us to find our rest, our peace, our provision, all in you. Help us to place our whole lot, our entire life, in your hands. Help us to wait on you, God. And Lord, we know you will lift us up. In Jesus' name, amen.
As Charlie mentioned, we'd like for you to join us on the choruses this morning. Words will be up here on the screen. And also, if you'd rather use a hymn book, you can find it on page 143. You will sing the choruses, and it begins with a chorus, and the choir will sing the verses. Thanks for joining us. You may remain seated, though.
Thank you, choir. Thank you, choir. And all God's people said once again,
Amen. Amen.
As we come to Holy Communion, you've already heard Pastor Ken explain that we practice an open table. That means that all persons of all faith backgrounds and all ages, yes, even kids with God, parents' good guidance, are invited and welcome to fully participate in the sacrament. And we invite you to be attentive to our entire conversation and prayer around Holy Communion as part of your worship. For on-site worshipers, if you haven't received, picked up one of those prepackaged communion elements, raise your hands real high right now, and the ushers will bring them to you. They're ready to do that. Leave your hand way high in the air so they don't miss you. And if you're with us online, please use crackers, grain, juice, or water, any drink that you have, and make sure to have enough for everyone with you at your location. And be prepared to receive the bread and then the cup all together, as I'll provide good guidance in a few moments. Holy Communion with the bread and the drink are an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual work and grace of God, by which we are drawn closer to Christ and closer to one another. And the special prayer that we'll say at this table, at this special meal, the great thanksgiving, the Eucharistic prayer, the communion prayer, we will do it in an ancient first century Jewish style, face to face, eyes open, and I'll invite you to repeat one word after me whenever I say it, that word being Amen.
Amen.
Gracious and loving God, thank you for your presence. As a creator of all things, God, we see your majesty around us. It's unmistakable. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, God, for demonstrating yourself as being able in all things that we observe, all things that we need, all things that we hope for and expect. God, you are able. Amen. Thank you, God, for your Son Jesus, your complete presence on earth as a human being. God, you brought Jesus to teach us and show us how to live with you in everything, how to put our life into you, how to live love. Thank you for Jesus' life and teaching, his ministry and healing. Thank you, God, for his death on the cross for us, his new life from the grave, and thank you, God, for the continuing life of Jesus with us, even here and now. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, we remember how your Son Jesus was at supper with his disciples the night before he gave himself up for us. Jesus took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat this. It is my body broken for you. Eat this to remember me." And in the same way, after the supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, shared it with his friends, saying, "Drink from this, all of you, because this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and countless others for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this to remember me." Amen. Thank you, gracious God, for these gifts of bread and cup. As we receive these gifts today, remind us to focus on your Son Jesus, to place our lives, our hopes, our expectations, all in your Son Jesus. We faithfully receive your nourishment, your breath, your spirit today through these gifts. Amen.
Amen.
Friends, when we break the bread in our places of worship, we are sharing in the body of Christ. And when we give thanks over the cups in our places of worship, we are sharing in the blood of Christ. And so, friends, please recognize all the gifts of God for all the people of God in every place. Amen. So now if you'll take the cracker, bread, or grain that you have and be prepared to eat it when I do. This is the body of Christ broken for us. Amen. And then the cup, if you will. This is the blood of Christ shed for us. Amen. Amen. And now with all the confidence of children of God, we pray together the prayer the Lord Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So friends, I invite you to stand as you're able for our closing hymn.
Of those who do such excellent work making sure we can host worship each week. If church and worship are new to you or you're new to PUMC, thank you for being here today and let us know how we might be helpful. We'd love to hear from you. Between the end of seminary and my first 3 years of ministry, I consider myself an expert in that waiting period. We also have another name for it. We call it a liminal space. And certainly over the last 2 years of the pandemic, we are all very familiar with that liminal space. As we wait for things to return to normal, as we wait for things to return to how they used to be. But we indeed have hope. We have hope that Jesus will continue to be with us, that God will be with us as we step out back into the world. So, my friends, the sermon is over. Now let the service begin. Go in peace.